morning. Welcome to the program tonight. Our sign language interpreter is William Silla, and I am Yvonne Okwara-Matole. 10 people have reportedly been killed at Kum and Baragoi areas in Samburu County after bandits attacked the area early today. 8 were killed at Kum along the border of Samburu and the Isiolo counties, while the other 2 were killed in Baragoi area. Authorities say an unknown number of livestock was stolen during the morning raid. Samburu Governor Moses Leonard Kulal has condemned the attack and called for action to apprehend the raiders.
It's quite pathetic, and we want to urge the security apparatus to respond. The fighting is still going on, and it's quite unfortunate. We know most of our livestock now are headed towards our border with Isiolo, and probably we have quite a number of livestock reported stolen. But we should be able to get a confirmed report by close of today.
Now, the National Super Alliance today sought to reassure its supporters that it was still intact, contrary to reports that it was facing an imminent split. Top leaders, including Kalonzo Musyoka, Moses Wetangula, and Musalia Mudavadi, took their campaigns to Kitengela in Kajiado County as they dismissed reports of a deadlock in the talks to pick NASA presidential flag bearer. And as Marimi Mwangi reports, the opposition is planning to hold a rally in Nairobi Wednesday next week.
In yet another raid on an area regarded as a battleground, the National Super Alliance took its campaigns to Kitengela in Kajiado County.
Wakenya hoye!
And once again, the opposition leaders dismissed reports of a crack in the Super Alliance that is seeking to remove Jubilee from power.
We commit no crime. Therefore, one NASA, the principles are united. Do not divide us.
The enemy of this country is the one who is telling each one of us to stand alone.
He hema ni hema yetu. Na sisi tuwe kwa hiyo hema. Hata joto ikiwa namna gani, tubaki ndani ndani ya hiyo hema.
The leaders rubbished President Uhuru Kenyatta's recent State of the Nation address, accusing the Jubilee government of failing Kenyans on key development pledges. They cited runaway corruption in government and the recent crisis in the country's healthcare system that saw Kenya import doctors from the neighboring countries.
I am a doctor of medicine. Uhuru, there is no doctor in Tanzania. When you raise a great apple, you never have a nurse. Okay, come here with me, I'm a doctor.
Serikali ya NASA ina mpangilio kushinda zile za Jubilee.
Siku za mwezi ni ngapi? Tariki nane mwezi wa nane ikifika, wafunge virago waende wapi?
Kajiado County is politically strategic to NASA. Post-Governor David Nkendienye was elected on the ODM party ticket in 2013. This even as 52% of the Kajiado electorate voted for President Uhuru Kenyatta, with ODM leader Raila Odinga garnering 44% of the county's presidential vote. 7 of the key county posts went to Jubilee, including the woman representative, the senatorial seat, and 4 members of parliament. ODM only captured the Kajiado Central parliamentary seat. But the opposition leaders asked residents to vote out all the Jubilee elected leaders.
Kaza anaitwa Ole Lengu. alishindwa kulinda polisi ataweza Kajiado kweli?
With the overriding theme of opposition unity dominating the NASA rally here, the puzzle of joint nomination will no doubt remain a key headache for the opposition as the jostle for the presidential ticket continues. Muremi Mwangi, KTN News, Kitengela, Kajiado County.
Still on politics, Deputy President William Ruto has called for unity amongst Kenyans as the country gears up for the general election in August. The deputy president asked Christians to pray for campaigns and elections to allow Kenyans choose the leaders they want. Ruto expressed the government's commitment to create the necessary environment for the conduct of the elections.
Ni maombi yetu na nia yetu ya kwamba viongozi wote wa dini, wa kisiasa na wale wengine sote tutaungana kutafuta vile tutakuwa na uchaguzi wenye huru na wa haki na wa amani tarehe 8 mwezi wa 8 mwaka huu. Muombee sisi katika Jubilee, muombee wale walio katika vyama vingine ili sote tuwe tayari kwa uchaguzi mkuu ujao. Tusiwe na vizuizi na watu ambao wanapanga eti mambo yafanyike ambayo sivyo. We want to work together so that we can have elections in August this year.
All right, so just what is in a name? Political players have gone a notch higher and changed their names from what initially existed in their birth certificates to names which they have either coined or been associated with. Kabete MP Ferdinand Waititu is the latest politician to officially change his name by adding the name Baba Yao in his official documents ahead of the August 8th elections. And as Chris Thiru reports, communication experts term this move as a way of branding that will easily resonate well with the public.
As the political campaign's drumbeats continue to get louder, political players have not been left behind. They seek to popularize themselves using all means. The name that most of the politicians associate with remains key in their campaigns. And it is on this fact that more and more politicians are now officially adopting their nicknames. It all started with Nairobi Senator Mike Mbuvi Kioko, who was forced to officially adopt the name Sonko. This is a name that was coined by his supporters for his generosity to the community through the Sonko Rescue Team.
Nobody remembers Sonko is Mike Mbuvi. They only know Sonko. If you remove the word Sonko from him, nobody will know him again. So I think it is the trend where they have no choice but to pick.
Sonko is a name that sells very well among the young people because in street language, basically means a person of means, a person who can, you know, they have, the person who can sort out other people's problems. So many young people aspire to be songos. Many young people aspire to have means.
The latest politician to officially adopt his nickname in his official documents is Kabete MP Ferdinand Waititu. Waititu officially adopted the name Baba Yao, which was coined during the 2013 general election. During the 2013 campaigns, Waititu positioned himself as the man behind the TNA campaigns in the capital city, thus acquiring the name Baba Yao.
This is a name that came up in run-up to 2013 elections because there were a number of candidates on TNA party. And, you know, it's like he was the boss among them. And, you know, it's like I'm in charge, I'm their father, I'm, you know. I'm the father of the city, and it sold so well that everybody seeing Waititu is like, oh, that's our father, that's Baba Yao.
According to communication expert Ben Wakoli, the official changing of names in one's identity card is not a new phenomenon among politicians, and it is not due to change.
We have had these cases, they have not started now. You remember the former former president of Uganda, Idi Amin Dada. You know, I'm told Idi Amin Dada was a nickname, and he took it upon himself to now use it as a populist kind of a name. Then you go to DRC Congo, Mobutu. He once called himself Mobutu Sese Seko Kukubenda wa Sabanga, which means the cock that leaves no hen untouched. So people knew him as Kukubenda wa Sabanga, you know. And it went on like that to an extent that now even people forgot about his real names.
James Mathenge, otherwise known as Kanini Kega, is also among the Kenyan politicians who officially changed their names.
Kanini Kega actually means a small person and a very good person. So people, when voters went to vote and they were looking for Kanini Kega, the name Kanini Kega, they couldn't get. They were only getting Mathenge, three other Mathenges, and it was very, very difficult to identify which Mathenge they were talking about. And that is the reason I decided to officially change my name.
But what is the procedure to change one's name?
It's called a deed poll. You're getting a deed poll. You have to get, of course, permission from your parents. You have to get permission from your spouse and any person who is related to you. And the state also has to accept that you are not running away from liabilities. Because the moment you change your name, it means that all the other liabilities or assets change with you.
Other politicians who have been forced to officially adopt their nicknames include Murang'a Governor Mwangi Wa Iria, who adopted the name Iria, meaning milk, because he was a former managing director of the new KCC. Not left behind was Kiambu Senator Kemani Wamatangi.
Most of these names comes from their activities, their community activities, what they do within the community and how people recognize them. You look, for instance, the Kiambu Senator Wamatangi. I'm told he used to sell water drums, water tanks to community women and also supply them. So people recognize him as somebody of tanks.
In Kiambu County, two aspiring aspirants for the Kiambu Township Ward have been forced to adopt their nicknames in order to resonate well with their supporters. One is David Kamande, who has been forced to adopt the name David Wapants. This because he hooks women underpants. The other is Francis Koina, who is a boda boda rider, who has been forced to adopt the name Waboda Boda.
Watu wengi sana sana katika hii ward ya township wananijua kijana wa boda boda ama kijana wa pikipiki, kwa maana wao ndio walinichukua wakaweza kunishikiria katika hii kinganganyiro cha MCA.
Kini commodity, you have to get a brand. So my brand is Kanini Kega, and it is unique because there is no other person who goes by the same name. So you mentioned Kanini Kega, and one thing comes to mind, one person who is MP for Kieni.
I thank God my name is very unique. Elachi is not with many people, so it's still a very unique name, and I thank God for that.
As the August 8th elections fast approaches, more and more politicians are still in the rush to officially change their names and adopt the nicknames that will finally appear at the ballot paper so that their supporters can easily recognize them. Chris Dairu, KTN News.
A section of leaders from Mandera have launched a new party, the Economic Freedom Party, which they intend to use in the coming general election. The launch of the EFP party in Mandera town comes at a time when politics in the county is fast changing due to the role of the Council of Elders.
The launch of the new party comes barely 5 months to the elections. Among the leaders aligned to the party are former Rift Valley Provincial Commissioner Hassan Noor, who is also eyeing the position of governor. According to the leaders, the formation of EFP is to ensure that candidates nominated by Council of Elders through the so-called negotiated democracy get the tickets to vie for various positions.
EFP itatuongoza, itatutoa katika hali ya umaskini ambayo tulio nao kwa wakati huu. Kwa hivyo tuwe tayari sote kama wakaji wa Mandera, tujiokoe na tujisaidie.
At the event characterized by the politics of clanism, The leaders urged locals who form the main sub-tribes in Mandera to support the new party. The leaders emphasized that during the 2013 presidential election, Mandera County gave 98% of votes to the government, and they can still marshal the same numbers to eject rebels who have defied the elders' wishes.
Mara mingi sana tumetafuta Jubilee, lakini leo tuko na chama yetu, sio? Chama ya Wakenya wote, sio? Sasa tunataka kuonyesha, wenye wametuonyesha, wamechukua Jubilee. Kura ni ya kutoka wananchi, sio?
The launch of the new party comes at a time when the Council of Elders in Mandera County felt duped by Jubilee Party. The Economic Freedom Party will fill all the seats in Mandera County as it plans to market itself in the larger northeastern region.
Wakati nilisema party haita.
Jaffa Isaac of the Diligent Development Alliance has denied claims that his party is among those that have joined Jubilee Party ahead of the August 8th elections. Speaking to journalists today, he said he will not support Jubilee or NASA, claiming both of them are tribal-based.
We cannot join the current politician because the ideas of today that we have today has failed this nation since 1960 to date. The way we do our politics has failed this nation to date. We want to rewrite narratives. We want to come up with a different idea, and our idea will take time. Don't expect the DDA to form the government 2022 or 2017 or 2027. This is a struggle that will go on with it. It will take a lot of time. You have to be patient with us.
The Diligent Development Alliance was registered in 2015 and has so far attracted 28,000 members.
A section of Baringo County leaders have dismissed reports that they are opposed to the ongoing security operation in the area. The leaders, who included Baringo Senator Gideon Moi, however, said the operation should be conducted in a humane manner. They said those interfering with the operation should be dealt with according to the law. The leaders, who were speaking at Emining Center during the official opening of the NATO AIC Church, said divisive leaders should not be elected in the August fall.
Na ile tunasemanga kwa kilugha kibagenge linyoa. Sindio?
Kila mtu anyanganywe silaha, silaha ibaki na serikali. We cannot arm citizens to fight each other. We can only disarm them because we have an armed government.
We really welcome the KDF. We really welcome them. Let them come and do the full operation. Remove all the guns in Diati, in anywhere. We don't want guns again.
While the rest of the country prepares to see the first SGR trains taking off in June this year, pupils in a school in Sultan Hamoud are bearing the brunt of the project, as their school is now almost out of bounds thanks to the barbed wire fences around the railway tracks. Parents have to escort their children to school at dawn, while those living near the railway beg their neighbors to allow them access out of their very own land. Mark Namaswa brings you the negative part of this otherwise good project.
Since its founding in 2002, pupils of Ilmao Primary School near Sultan Hamoud Kajiado have never worried about accessing their school and heading back home. But today, the distance has multiplied thanks to the barbed wire fencing of SGR project.
Umetoka kutoka vijiji vingi ambayo imetusunguka hapa. Wengine wametoka unaona ule ulima.
The school has a population of 220 pupils from nursery school to class 8. For 11-year-old Lenny Solanka, who is in class 4, the new inconvenience is too much to bear.
Asubuhi tumekuja tukapata njia imefungwa, tukaambiwa hakuna njia. Tukaambiwa tupite kwa leo, tukaambiwa tuvuke hapo kwa leo.
Absenteeism, transfer or dropping out is now a major concern for teachers here.
Inawabidi wazazi waamshe watoto usiku. Wanakuja usiku na hapa ukijaribu kuangalia kuna msitu.
These barbed wire fences are meant to keep away children from straying over onto the railway tracks. But teachers here have the constant fear that one of their cheeky pupils might just jump over the fence and go onto the railway tracks.
tulikuwa tumewauliza hii italete shida. Wakatuambia watajenga ukuta. Watajenga ukuta kwamba itazuia ile sauti.
So land owners have been compensated on both sides of the railway. Some are equally marooned just as the school. Jeremiah Olesein has lived here since 1997, but the hiving off of part of the land here has left him among those begging their neighbors to let them pass through their land.
Huyu mzee ambaye yuko hapa karibu ni neighbor yangu. Na shamba yake iko chini ambayo baba inaenda kushika, lakini mwenzake alikataa kutoa hiyo njia.
Seemingly aware of the predicament locals might undergo crossing the railway, underpasses were built at various points along the railway, but they ran into private shambas. Kenya Railways Corporation MD Athanas Maina says his organization is aware of the ongoings and is doing something about it. He says, Ilmao primary students in Sultan Hamoud recently had their movements hindered due to neighboring landlords demarcating their properties. They fenced off their lands right up to the SGR fence, which has blocked access for the students. We are looking into finding an amicable solution to this problem and improving accessibility for the students. Organizations such as the Kenya Coalition for Wildlife Conservation and Management have been at loggerheads with the SGR construction, particularly phase two.
And while the community itself and even ourselves are not opposed to development, what we are saying is that development must be sustainable and the development must also respect the state of the environment as provided for in the constitution.
In the meantime, for Lenny Solanka and other Ilmao pupils, until corridors are put alongside the railway track, every school day will remain a day to make a great trek to and from school. Mark Namaswa, KTN News.
All right, so tonight on Checkpoint, we're discussing the issue of hate speech in the country, considering that we've got just a few months to the election. Why are we discussing this today, you ask? Well, let's take a look at some of the cases, some of the high-profile ones that have existed in the country, been to the courts. This is what has triggered this discussion tonight. Mishi Mboko, who's the women representative in the coastal region, was acquitted last week. Now, this is a little brief about the case. She made this statement: Kenyans are going to bring a revolution. Enough is enough. We're tired. Revolution is with the people. People power, people power. This was the statement that got her to court. Three offenses of promoting ethnic hatred. The judge dismissed this case, saying the prosecution did not prove the case beyond reasonable doubt, saying she didn't mention a specific community, and said, in any case, a revolution of the people is not in itself an offense. If you think this is the only one, there have been many other high-profile cases. So let's remind you of some of those. Babu Owino, a student leader at the University of Nairobi, was acquitted. Actually, this happened in February of this year. He was acquitted of incitement to violence charges. Again, the judge said the prosecution failed to prove its case, even though Babu Owino himself admitted to making the remarks for which he was charged, but he said he did not mean to cause any harm. Now, after him, there was William Kabogo, who's the governor for Kiambu County. Also, again, this is a common thread you will see in a number of these cases. Prosecution presented weak evidence is what was said in his particular case. Let's go now to two cases that were quite prominent in this country as part of those Pangani Six. Moses Kuria, who was acquitted over those statements that he made, they were widely played across all media houses in this country. The judge in this one was a very controversial and interesting case, questioned the authenticity of the clip because he said the original maker of the video remained unknown throughout the case, and that was the same thing for Ferdinand Waititu, even going on to say that the English and Kiswahili translations were not correct. Now, this authenticity of the clip was what was controversial because the clips were obtained from media houses and the Communications Authority of Kenya had actually authenticated them as being, they were authenticated by them. Now, in that case, the DPP said he's going to appeal the ruling. He termed it, quote, strange. Let's take a look at another one. And as you can see, it goes across the political divide. So this is an interesting one as well. Johnson Muthama was also acquitted. We will come to this one in just a moment when we come to our discussion. But Johnson Muthama was acquitted. He was dismissed. The case was dismissed And the judge in that case called it an abuse of the court process, and that happened in July 2016. So these are some of the cases that make one wonder what is going on with the fight against hate speech. But these are what's happening with prominent individuals, and there are many others, and we'll get into that. But I want you to remember that there was a young man called Alan Wadi who was charged with insulting the president and, of course, causing ethnic hatred to a community. His case proceeded very fast. He was jailed for 2 years. Of course, that is the case. He's no longer in prison. But it just shows you how quickly that case was concluded as opposed to these others. So is there selective application of the law when it comes to hate speech? And do all of these cases and their acquittals create a precedence of impunity as we head towards the 2017 August elections? That is the discussion we will be having just after the break. Remember, our question on Twitter continues, so please continue to send in your thoughts on SMS as well. My guest tonight, we have Professor Michael Wainaina, who's our resident analyst here with us. And new to Checkpoint, but certainly someone we're hoping to hear a lot of robust contributions from today, is Joy Mdivo. We welcome her to Checkpoint tonight. Francis Olekapara from Mombasa will not be making it with us due to a technical hitch with our studios in Mombasa, but we'll definitely have a robust conversation nonetheless. That's all coming up after the break, so stay with us. All right, so welcome back to Checkpoint. We thank you for staying with us, and we thank you for continuing to send in your feedback. The SMS number is 22155. That's absolutely free. And on Twitter at KTN News, at Yvonne Okwara, the hashtag to use is Checkpoint. Has the NCIC succeeded in curbing cases of hate speech? An important time in the country, a lot of political rhetoric. Who is there to wield the big stick when we're seeing all the acquittals in the judiciary so far? So keep your comments coming in on that. To discuss this with me this evening, on my right is Professor Michael Wainaina, who's our resident analyst. Good to see you again. And on my left is Joy Brenda Mdivo, who's an advocate and a member, council member of the Law Society of Kenya, governance and expert as well. But we want to start on phone with the chair of the NCIC, that's the National Cohesion Integration Commission. He was supposed to be at our Mombasa studios, but he'll join us on phone now. To start off this conversation, Bwana Chairman, thank you so much for joining us on Checkpoint via phone tonight. Let's just start by a quick reaction with the acquittal in the judiciary of Mishi Mboko. Hers is not the first. There's many others, and we start to wonder, how the fight against hate speech will carry on in the country with a number of these things, considering we're in the campaign season. What's your reaction to all of this that's been taking place?
Well, first of all, thanks for getting hold of me on phone. I am shocked, by the way, by the series of acquittals on hate speech, which seem also to be synchronized. We've had a series within 1 week of acquittals on what I could only describe some of them as on very strange grounds. I do not know whether, as a matter of fact, the judiciary does take into consideration the public good, and whether or not they actually think that they live in another country and another planet. I am shocked.
All right, let's talk about the evidence, because in a number of the cases that we're seeing acquittals, the judges consistently seem to say one thing, that the prosecution presents weak evidence that cannot sustain a conviction. And some say that then that goes back to the doorstep of the Integration Commission, because you have investigatory powers. So is it that perhaps the work of the commission that is failing in this process of ensuring convictions?
Well, first of all, you are wrong. You are absolutely wrong. We do not have investigatory powers. All investigatory powers under law are in the hands of the police, particularly the Criminal Investigation Department. But we do have attached to us a few investigators, but we also work closely with of players in this. Chief among them is the press. It is the press that actually reports what has been said in many public functions. And they also, on occasion, provide clips, either to us, or they put it on YouTube, or they finally end up on your television set or in newspapers. But when that does happen, a flood of things happen, including a demand by the public, rightfully, to get those responsible charged. And as you know, you must get the evidence to be able to go to court. Oftentimes, when we reach out to the responsible journalist who aired or put in print in the first place that utterance, the most common response is that we cannot disclose our sources because it's against our professional etiquette, and they deny to go to court. So that is hurdle number one. Number two, if it is sent by a member of the general public, more often than not, they too may not be able to come and stand in court and say, I took that picture or I recorded that voice. And therefore, we have a lot of challenges. But that notwithstanding, there have been cases where sufficient evidence have been presented to the director of public prosecution, who in turn charges those suspects, because you must understand that it is again the sole duty of the director of public prosecution to prefer charges against anybody. It's not the business of NCIC.
Okay.
We don't have that responsibility. But of course, we work very closely with those other government agencies. And you cannot deny the fact that some of the acquittals have been based on very dubious grounds.
Okay, all right. Just stay with us on phone if you can. As we continue to have this discussion, I'd like to engage my studio guests for that. Joy, I want to start with you. You've heard what the chair of the NCIC has said, talking about the media, providing the sources, and indeed, the DPP also being the one that presents this case and decides we have enough to charge them. What is the legal framework for this, and do you agree with what the chair is saying?
One thing that the chair said is that they do not have power to investigate, which I find to be less than candid, because if you read the NCIC Act, one of their functions is to actually investigate. And they've been given equal power to what a high court judge would have, the power to summon, the power to take evidence, to even compensate witnesses for their time. That's one thing. It is within their ambit. They can do it. Secondly, if you are a body that is tasked with looking into such matters, I don't see why you're relying on journalists for your evidence. You should have people attending rallies, collecting the evidence for yourself, primary evidence, because this was a public place. It was not a private meeting. They did not have to rely on insider information. It's something that they could have done for themselves if they were serious about prosecuting these cases. Another thing that I've heard Ole Kaparo saying, which, by the way, is a man that I respect, is that the courts sometimes are failing because they dismiss matters because the evidence is lacking and is wanting. You must understand that when it is a criminal matter, the standard of proof is high. It is beyond reasonable doubt. If you cannot meet that threshold, the judicial officer has got no responsibility to try and make a case for somebody because
the chairman
there's
is
public
saying,
interest,
yeah,
there's public outcry.
Interest and
that
public
is not outcry. What rules them. What rules them is the rule of law.
And
if the law says that the evidence is lacking, it is lacking, it is wanting. Failing by the police, maybe. Failing by the CID, maybe. Maybe the prosecution is wanting, possibly. But whatever the situation, if an outcome is lack of evidence, then that is the outcome. The magistrate cannot go ahead and convict because there's a public outcry. That's not how it works.
Okay. There's also the political aspect of this, Prof. Like we've seen, they say sometimes, people of a high profile can easily get away with some of the statements. And by the way, those cases that we have highlighted a few minutes ago aren't the only ones. There's a number, including that of Chirawale Makweren. All he had to do was apologize. And yet for other people, you know, the threshold, perhaps they say, is much lower. The political aspect of curbing hate speech?
The political aspect of curbing hate speech worries me, and I will tell you why it does, in two ways. One, it does seem that the laws that govern NCIC or its operations or its objectives or its reason for existence were crafted so that it would fail. And therefore we have a commission and a chairman who is saying, I have a job, but I do not have the tools that I need to do this job. My problem with that is twofold. If it was made to fail, then what do we do about the issues of cohesion and integration? Because there are serious issues in this country, especially as we go towards elections, as you said. That's number one. Number two, the public service and the people who are entrusted with these things in this country need to get to a level where somebody feels that if they cannot do the job that they have been given to do, if you have been given a job and you have not been given the instruments to do the job, do something about it. Either get the instruments or tell Kenyans, this job is not doable. I am going home. But you cannot sit in a public office and every time you are lamenting that you do not have the instruments, you do not have the laws, you do not have the wherewithal to do the job that Kenyans expect you to do. The issue of integration and cohesion is a huge issue in this country. As we approach the elections, I don't think there's any issue that is actually bigger than the issue of integration and cohesion. So we cannot have a commission that claims that they do not have the instruments to do what Kenyans expect to be done, and they are still in office.
Okay, that's an interesting one. I don't know if we still have the chairman on phone, because it will be interesting to get his response to that. Bwana Chairman, I don't know if you've had a chance to listen to what Professor Wainaina says, but his submission basically is if the commission has not been given the law, the instruments, and the powers to fight hate speech, that perhaps it should, you know, sound the alarm or resign.
I did listen. Hello?
Yes, yes. So what are your thoughts? He says if you don't have the instruments to do your work, then you should either be raising the alarm, going back to Parliament to get the laws fixed, or simply step aside. What's your reaction to that?
Well, let me just first commend him. His first part of his argument, we have a commission. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can, Bwana Chairman. Carry on.
That we do have a commission that was quickly put in place as a result of the conflict in 2007-2008. Mm-hmm. It was quickly done. Mm-hmm. It was not homegrown. It was an impostation. It was put in place because we had a problem to sort out there and then. And I do not know whether to agree with him on his assertion that it was crafted in such a way that it had to fail. But let's also come back to reality. Reality is, and I want to also take issue with the lady advocate. I presume she's the advocate.
Yes.
I want to take issue with her because she seems to think that NCIC has all the people it requires to send to various places to go and gather that evidence. As a matter of fact, the total complement of NCIC, including the professional staff, the drivers, the team makers, everybody, is just under 50 people. serve the whole country. Indeed, the professional staff are under 30. I mean under 30. You must understand that that's to be a serious deficiency. I also understood the Professor Wainaina requesting that if we saw that we have a problem, we should talk about it. I honestly don't know whether he watches his news. On many times, I have met a general complaint about the inadequacy of A, the funding provided to NCIC, and two, the human element, the personnel, and thirdly, the law, the requisite law that makes NCIC operate or operate inadequately. I have met those complaints and presentations. I have made a proposal to Parliament on several occasions, including presenting to them draft amendments to the NCIC Act 2 years ago. They are almost going home without considering that.
Okay.
I have valiantly tried to do what has to be done. Finally, it is not fair to just look at NCIC and hate speech. We have done a lot of work in reconciling communities across Kenya. But also remember this, from Marsabit, Mandera, Isiolo, Samburu, Baringo, the one that is on fire right now, Nandi and Kakamega, Nandi and Kisumu, Mount Elgon, name it. We have made tremendous efforts. And a lot of Kenyans in those areas today are living in peace thanks to NCIC. But we seem to think about NCIC and hate speech. Finally, and this is a common Kenyan malady. Everybody seems to think that somebody else must do this apart from me. Let me tell you, the issue of cohesion, of hate, of incitement, of warmongering is a national problem. We need a combined effort of every right-thinking Kenya to combat it.
Okay.
You and the panelists included.
All right, okay. Just very quickly then, because you've talked about the work in integrating communities and reconciling them, but you've also mentioned a number of the constraints, funding, personnel, and the laws. So answer this question that we have put out to our viewers tonight. Because of considering all of these constraints, would you say the NCIC has been successful in curbing hate speech in the country?
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can now.
Okay, great. So we're asking, considering all the constraints you have talked about, funding, personnel, and the laws, please answer the question that we're putting to our viewers, whether you think your commission has been successful in curbing hate speech.
It has not. And it has not because of various factors. Some of it is external to it. We could have done better. I began this interview with a lamentation that indeed we are unable to fight this monster of hate speech because we are not allowed to do so from every quarter.
Okay.
From the legal aspect to the prosecution to the court itself. We cannot do all those things ourselves.
All right, okay.
Everybody must play their role.
All right, so interesting what the chairman is saying. He actually admits they have not. He's talking about an imposition after the 2007-2008, and yet we have remained in this situation knowing we have this challenge from that point in time. So where does this leave us now?
You know, when you read the NCIC Act, one thing that stands out is the way the law was crafted, which is, I join issue with Honorable Kaparo, it was drafted in such a way that it is reactionary. Mm-hmm. When you read it, it doesn't lend itself. You don't know what mischief is being cured.
Mm-hmm.
Don't discriminate, don't insult, don't abuse.
Mm-hmm.
Things that if we were to break it down legally and say, okay, fine, what then is an insult worthy of discharge?
Right.
It is something that is so difficult to pin down.
Uh-huh.
So the law itself has been crafted in a way that it is easy to sneak out and wriggle out of it. Now, if you look at it vis-a-vis, and this is a culture, by the way, we have in Kenya. You've had this accusation with the EACC,
mm-hmm.
saying that the law was crafted in a way that when it became expedient, you can defeat it.
That's exactly what Prof is saying.
And the weakness, now what happens is you have judicial officers who, for example, in the penal code, there is actually a crime that if you make utterances that incite people to warlike behavior,
mm-hmm.
then you are liable to life imprisonment. But here we come and we are relying on this law on hate speech, where the fine is $1 million. I mean, these days, lotto winners have $1 million. It's one of those things that makes you wonder, when they were drafting this law, what was the mischief they were trying to cure? In my opinion, it was crafted with politicians in mind. So you look like you're doing something,
mm-hmm.
but in actual fact, you're doing a lot of nothing.
Okay.
Because if the rubber meets the road, they'll all get off the hook. It's there's only one consequence.
Interesting that you talk about that, because I'd like us to put up on screen, because a lot of people on social media as well, when we said we're going to discuss this, asked, so what is the definition of hate speech, and do we really understand it, considering Babu Owino himself admitted to making the remarks, but said, well, you know, I mean, I said what I said, but I didn't mean any harm.
Exactly.
And it's good that we have a professor in literature, and perhaps we can take a look at this text, which is from Section 13 of the NCIC Act. So it's a bit wordy, but bear with me, because I think I find this rather interesting. We'll have it on our screens in just a moment. But the section of that act says that a person who uses threatening, abusive, or insulting words or behavior, I'm hoping we can have it on our screens really quickly so our viewers can follow this text with us, shows or plays a recording of visual images, which is threatening, abusive, or insulting, or involves the use of threatening, abusive, or insulting words, commits an offense, Prof, here's where it gets interesting, if such a person intends thereby to stir up ethnic hatred. Okay, so the law is also supposed to understand intent? Isn't that where it gets a little confusing? What are your thoughts on this?
It not only gets a little confusing, it gets a lot confusing. One of the things that we have to appreciate, Yvonne, is that hate speech is largely coded language. Okay, it is not even the section that you have read does not even start to do it justice, because when we are dealing with issues of hate speech, I can give you the example of Rwanda. Rwanda, they were using the word cockroaches.
Yes.
Okay. And they were saying, kill the cockroaches.
Nyenzo, in fact,
yes,
was the word.
Yes.
Yeah.
And if you ask the person who has uttered that and say that it is hate speech, they will say, I was just telling people to kill the cockroaches in their kitchen.
Right.
When the genocide happened, we got to know who the cockroaches were, and they were not the ones in the kitchen.
Mm.
They were Tutsis and moderate Hutus.
Mm.
Looking at the law that we have, and this is why I have said that we have ourselves a law and a commission that was set to fail from the very beginning.
Mm-hmm.
What Mr. Ole Kaparo is shockingly honest and sincere. He is telling Kenyans, you are on your own. I have been in this. I have tried what I can do. I don't have the instruments. I have failed. If you are looking for reconciliation and integration going to the elections, you are on your own. My challenge with this, Yvonne, is that we have a system that is generally so dysfunctional that the president blames the judiciary.
Mm-hmm.
The judiciary blames
the
DPP. DPP blames
the police. Yeah.
The police blame everybody. That nobody says the buck stops here. This has got to be done. Yet, we, as the people of Kenya, are paying taxes. They are paying salaries to the commission, to all government workers, including Ole Kaparo. He is drawing a salary every month. And I hope that we are going to get to a level in this country where public servants can
be level with the people of Kenya and say, you know what? This thing was cobbled up in 2007 to hoodwink the people who wanted peace. I don't think that this thing was set up to bring integration and reconciliation. I think you're being taken for a ride, and I'm not going to be part of this.
Okay, interesting. I don't know if we have the chair, but let's see if we can put him to task over those statements, including the statements that he made. Bwana Okaparo, you said this was, and I quote, an imposition. Mm-hmm. On the people. Mm-hmm. You've lamented some of the challenges that are there. And you've even gone on to say that, you know, every time there's a case of hate speech or cohesion in the country, everybody looks to you, yet it is something that all Kenyans should do. But to be fair, Bwana Ole Kaparo, you are the chair of the National Cohesion and Integration Commission, for which you draw a salary. Should there not be a champion that fights this cause, and that is the commission and yourself as the chair?
I have done my best. I continue to do my best. And I want to tell those blaming us that it is very easy to blame, but very difficult to execute. As I have said in the past, a few minutes ago, we have done a lot of work in reconciling communities across Kenya. It is a fact. Those people can sleep today. They were not sleeping then. If that is not a service to Kenyans, I don't know what is. The issue of hate speech, I agree with the professor or the lady lawyer that that crafters of the law are also the consumers of charges of hate. And they probably made it not so strong to be able to cut it. Again, the tragedy is, if you want to change that law, you must return to politicians.
The same politicians.
We have done that. We have had workshops upon workshops with them. We've drafted amendments to the law. We've sent it to Parliament. It is pending in Parliament. But I don't like the whole idea of Professor Wainaina seeming to live in a very high pedestal where he doesn't do any wrong. Everybody else is at fault. He is the best in the world. I doubt it. There are limitations. Even where he works, there must be limitations. There must be some things he just can't fix. And it is also not right to demand that every time you get a challenge, you must quit. Then we'll be having a nation of quitters. And I am not that type. And by the way, for the information of this professor, I have attracted. And I think he honestly knows that I have done as well as I could in my past, and I continue to do so today. My call to the Kenyan people, there is no fun in hating each other.
Okay.
Indeed, we shouldn't be debarred from doing bad things because we go to jail. Let's what is honorable.
Okay.
And it is even biblical. Love thy neighbor, you love thyself. I'll continue to do what I can, and I hope everybody else does what they ought to do, including those who are being absolved of blame, when that blame could squarely be entirely on them.
Okay, thank you, Bwana Chairman, and of course is sort of starting to wrap this up a little bit, and we thank you for that, and we'll come to you for a reaction on that. But I'd like to talk about, you know, what the situation was like in 2013, because then the deputy and the president and his deputy then were facing the ICC cases, and many said that the atmosphere then was a little bit different, that politicians were a little more cautious because there was, you know, the looming ICC cases over two of them. Well, we know what happened thereafter. But, you know, there's that big stick, you know, that can be wielded. The ICC is not there now. The commissioner, the chair of the commission is saying, well, you know, these are the constraints I have. They have tried to work with communities, but in terms of putting politicians on notice, that's a bit of a challenge. What's your sense between the 2013 campaign and now, considering the events then and the events now? People are getting off with their cases at the courts, and at the time, ICC was, you know, looming large over our heads.
You know, the ICC case was, in fact, it became one of the coalescing questions for the last general election. It became, oh, we need to defend ourselves. So it became one of the campaign issues. So are we voting for criminals on one hand, on the other side, we are being persecuted. And that's what of the McCollins was important, because moving forward, even the atmosphere in the country, people were careful about their utterances, what they got out of the people, so that they were not seen to incite, because that was a threat. Now, remember earlier I alluded to what is in the penal code. And the penal code is very categorical, that if you incite people without lawful authority to make preparation to generate warlike activity, then you're liable to imprisonment for life. Now, why
so
that?
So it's already in the penal code?
We already have it in the penal code. We have had it since 1967. And it's one of those things where we apply the law in a manner that is favorable. If somebody issues an utterance and says, a certain ethnic group, if you carry on like this, then chumachenu kimotoni, that to me is incitement to warlike activity. That is something that can be proved using the words that have been uttered and the response from the crowd that you're speaking to. But now when you choose to go with this very ambiguous, I mean...
So do we need that very, as you call it, very ambiguous NCIC Act? Do we need the commission at all?
That act needs to just go away. It is a very badly drafted law because it was drafted with so much ambiguity. Because it's like, for example, the law on treason. We've had this criticism before. When you even imagine the death of the president, it is actionable. Yeah. How are you going to prove that I'm imagining the death of a president beyond reasonable doubt in a courtroom? It's next to impossible. Or like witchcraft. If you do activities with the aim of harming others, and it is... These are spiritual things. Where do you pin somebody down?
Right.
So there are some laws in Kenya that were drafted, in my opinion, specifically to provide the back door for escape. So it is meant to give people the impression that there's something going on. So this general election, ICC is no longer a threat. This general election, even
the
local courts
is no longer a threat. Yeah.
So people actually, it's open duck season. They're shooting in the air and there is nobody to tell them this is wrong. But like I pointed out, if our law enforcers just looked at what we already have and applied it strictly, in my opinion, the courts need the support from the DPP's office and from the investigators to be able to just put one person away.
Yeah.
Look at what happened when Honorable Muthama and the others, the famous six, Pangani six,
right,
when they spent the 4 nights, I mean, the atmosphere across the political divide, it was immediate. We just need decisive action. One person will make a difference in the entire scenario.
Okay. So NCIC, does it help? And where do you see us going, towards August? Because, by the way, it's not just for politicians, but it also sets a precedent for ordinary Kenyans like you, like me. So, if so-and-so can say this, then, I'll post something and it's a pseudonym and I'm hiding behind a keyboard. So where does this leave us, Prof, ahead of August?
It leaves us in a very dangerous position. One of the things that I would like to say about Mr. Kaparo's response to my concerns is that we as Kenyans are honestly tired. And unfortunately, when we as Kenyans ask for results, when we ask for outputs, we are called utopian, we are called idealist, we are called people who don't get satisfied, we are called people who want too much. Is it too much for Kenyans to ask a commission for integration and cohesion to ask for integration and cohesion? I don't think it is too much. That is the name of the commission. The chairman of the commission has agreed that he has failed. And the Kenyan people are saying, when you fail, do you sit down and continue telling us you have failed and you have tried and you have done your best, or do we look for other options? That is number one. Number two, there is an argument again that Mr. Kaparo, with all due respect, is making in terms of this is our problem, all of us. Okay? Then why do we have a commission?
Why do we have a government? Why do we have anything? It is one of the arguments
but
that
isn't there merit, though, to what he says, that it's something collective that should happen on an individual level and perhaps grows to a community and
you know,
national level?
Yvonne, we have been told that corruption is our problem, all of us. We have been told that ethnicity
security.
Is our problem, all of us. We have been told that security is... The last time I checked, there was a government in this country.
Here,
why
here.
Do we elect a government?
Here, here.
Of what use is a government whose job is to tell you, by the way, this has nothing to do with me. You're on your own. The job of government is to govern and to give services to the people for which it has been elected.
Mm.
If it cannot be able to do that for whatever reason, then it needs to recuse itself, and we, the people, need to replace it with a government that is going to deliver. That is number two. Number three, Mr. Kaparo is talking about morality. Okay, he's quoting the Bible, and I think it is a good thing. To quote the Bible, it's a good thing to talk about morality when you're dealing with issues of cohesion and issues of integration and issues of hate speech. But there is a difference between morality and behavior. Morality cannot be legislated. You cannot make people love other people. But behavior can be regulated.
Thank you.
His job is to regulate behavior and make sure that nobody, no Mishiboko, stands on a rostrum and refers to an ethnic group and says, Chuma chako kiko motoni. If she does that and gets away with it, what he is telling us is that we are unable to regulate behavior that is warlike, and what we should expect in Agas is what that behavior would result to. Lastly, Yvonne, I get a sense, Yvonne, that Kenyans imagine that they are very special. Or, let me put it differently, Kenyans imagine that the Rwandese are mad people. Okay? They are mad people who had no education, who are, okay, they're just people who don't think. They were not mad people. They were a society that all the things that are related to genocide came together. What are these three things? Number one, identity politics.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, a rogue political class. And number three, a spark. In this country, we have two of those things in place. Number one, identity politics. Number two, a rogue political class. We are only waiting for the third one, the spark. And we have been told that something is going to happen to some of us if some people do not win the election in August. So if we have all the ingredients of conflagration have lined themselves up,
mm-hmm.
and you have a chairman of the Cohesion and Integration Commission saying, there is nothing I can do about it, I have done the best, only a very naive person wouldn't see where the country is headed.
All right, do we have the chairman? I'd like to give him the last word on this one. In just about a minute, you've heard from Joy, and she's talking about the laws and the fact that they cannot help us as they are. The prof is saying we're hurtling down to a very dangerous path. What's your last word, Wanachair?
Well, my last word is first, Joy, I agree with you. The law was badly drafted. I have tried to assist it. I have drafted requisite amendments. They are pending in Parliament. I hope they will consider it before Parliament ends its term. For Professor, I hope someday you will appreciate that speaking false is the easiest thing in the world. You refuse completely to listen to what I have said, that we have across the country reconciled several warring Kenyan communities successfully. It is, and we continue to do so. And we cannot. I gave 390 voice recorders to people we have hired as cohesion monitors across the country. We gave a similar number of camcorders to those cohesion monitors we have employed to be able to visit every rally across the country so that we don't depend on the reporters, we don't depend on police alone. They will be working together with police. We have also given specialized cameras to policemen, 47 of them, one per county, a specialized camera that can pick the voice and the picture at a 200 meter radius. Very, very powerful voice recorders. We just finished the training last Friday. They are back to their counties.
Okay.
You will see them on those rallies, and I hope they will also be able to get Professor Wainaina in some place. Then we can talk about it.
All right, thank you very much, Bwana Chair. Francis Olekaparo, who is the chair of the National Cohesion Integration Commission, he says they will be out there and they will be looking for you and for all of us indeed. Thanks for that, Bwana Chairman. Also, thank you, Professor Michael Wainaina, who's our resident analyst, Joy Brenda Mdivo, who's an advocate. The chair of the commission says he is not a quitter. They have reconciled communities. They may have failed in curbing hate speech, but there's a lot they've done. Prof says we're on our own and hurtling down towards a dangerous path. Joy says the legislation is all wrong and will not help us in this war against hate speech. What do you think? Please continue to give us your thoughts at KTN News, at Yvonne Okwara. The hashtag is Checkpoint 22155. I'll also be looking out for your SMSs. You're watching Checkpoint. We'll be right back. All right, so welcome back to Checkpoint. It's time for the number, and this is an interesting one. You know, every time we seem to think we have problems in Kenya, think again. So, Nana Akufo-Addo, who recently trounced John Dramani Mahama in Ghana, is in the process of setting up his cabinet. This is a number that you want to look out for this week. 110 is the total number of ministers in Ghana's new cabinet, some say, and counting. Let me just break down this number for you before we move on. 56 full ministers, 50 deputy, and 4 ministers of state. This is a record for Ghana. So 110 cabinet ministers, with a country with a total population of 27 million people. Now, of course, Nana Akufo-Addo rose to power on the promise to cut expenditure and fight corruption. 110. And he says there are huge problems in the country and that needs a huge team to fix those problems in his defense of this number. So let's just make a bit of a comparison. Nigeria has 35 ministers. Our neighboring in Uganda has 80 ministers and hundreds of advisors on just about everything you can think of. But let's come back home. So just in case you thought things were bad, 110 ministers in a population of 27 million people. And in Kenya, look at that number. Extremely humble. 20 cabinet ministers, cabinet secretaries as we call them now, for a population of, what, around about 45 million people. Even if you were to put together this number plus the number of principal secretaries, which is 41, the total would come to 61. Nowhere near the 110 that is already in place in Ghana. So, in this respect, perhaps, we're doing well with this number. So that's a number to remember for the week. All right, so now while we're speaking about numbers, it's important to remember that the conversation we're having now is that of the ballooning wage bill, right? Ghana seems to have no problem with it. We're fine with our 20 cabinet secretaries. But this was a big feature in the president's final State of the Nation address that we had last week before the August 2017 election. And of course, the big carrot that was being dangled in that speech was that of wage bill and a pay cut for government officials. Listen to this.
This report recommends, amongst other things and other measures, a rationalization of the salaries and allowances paid to senior state officers, public servants, elected officials from MCA all the way to president. That will result in a reduction in salaries and allowances for those elected in August this year.
All right, so lest we forget, we have heard this speech before, actually, in 2013, incidentally, at the State of the Nation address. Take a listen.
Leaders have shown themselves willing to lead by example. My cabinet secretaries and principal secretaries have accepted a 10% pay cut, and the deputy president joined me in taking a 20% pay cut.
Lest we forget, immediately after that speech, the SRC embarked on a national conference discussing the wage bill. So this has been a problem from 2013, 2014 through to 2017. Surely something needs to be done about this. So how many pay cuts exactly have they taken? There was a 20% one in 2013, and then there is another one. Will this be a recurrent thing? Well, lest we forget, it's a conversation we've had once before. As lest we forget tonight, we have the sports news and my take coming up next. Time for the day's sports news now. Defending Kenya Premier League champions Tusker FC's suffered their second loss in as many games this season after losing 2-0 to Thika United in a match played at the Thika Stadium. Eugene Mukangula opened the scoring for Thika in the third minute, heading past the Tusker defence. In the second half, Mukangula turned the provider as he set up Sammy Kibwana for the second of the match, heaping more misery into Tusker's campaign. In another match, AFC Leopards began their 2017 Kenya Premier League season with a convincing 3-0 win over Nakumat FC. Now, Will Besseling from Netherlands is the overall winner of the inaugural KCB Karen Masters Golf Championships that came to a conclusion at the Karen Golf Club in Nairobi. Besseling played a total 12 under par 132 to lift the two-day lucrative tournament that had a total prize of 1.5 million shillings. Another Dutchman, Rainer Saxton, scored 10 under par 134 to bag second place, while Englishman Tom Murray came third with a score of 8 under par 136. Kenya's Greg Snow finished fourth after carding 7 under par 137. The 42nd edition of the IAAF World Cross Country Championship is fast approaching, and the Kenyan team is now setting their tactics. The usual winning tactic was the use of Kalenjin language, something that will not be used in this year's championship by the Kenyan team because of the huge number of athletes who speak Kalenjin will be representing other countries. Moses Wahisi now tells us why a different tactic will be used.
For a number of years, Kenyan athletes have been using Kalenjin language to their advantage anytime they compete against different countries on the international events. Ngebe, a word in Kalenjin meaning let's go, always a pointer when to break off, but with a lineup that consists of Kalenjin athletes that have donned their Kenyan passport for other nationalities at the IAAF World Cross Country Championship set for Kampala, Uganda, language will not be used as the tactics by the Kenyan kings and queens of the track.
Ngebe has been our nini, but today we have another slogan, and we are not going to say it right now.
Mwaka hii tunakuwa na war different na ile miaka ingine, lakini hatuogopi, tuko tayari, tunajua namna ya kudili na hao watu, lazima tuko tayari.
As a team, as you go out to fight, if you're going for a fight, you must be prepared well. You must be able to know the strength of your opponent. And that is what we've done. We know what is going to be in Uganda. We know the weather that is expected in Uganda.
Talk about the Kenyan expert. Team USA will line up among them Samuel Chelanga, Stanley Kebenei, Shadrach Kipchirchir, and USA national cross-country champion 30-year-old Leonard Koril in its cross-country team. Also Olympic 5,000 meters silver medalist Paul Chelimo is one of the four athletes named for the mixed relay for Team USA. Another Kenyan lineup, one might argue.
I think they are like thieves. Huh?
If you run away from your country, how do you expect to win? Because if they saw Kenyans, they would be at least they would be afraid.
Team Uganda will be led by Timothy Cherotich, a four-time world cross-country champion. Ugandan team will also have Stephen Kiprotich, the 2012 Olympic and 2013 world champion in the marathon. Joshua Cheptegei, the 2014 world and the 2010,000 meters champion and 2015 African junior cross-country gold medalist, is also part of the neighbor's side, an indication of why Kenyan will be against Kenyan B, and Ngebe, as they say it in Kalenjin, will no more be the tag team.
We believe in whatever we have done, and we have done enough training, and we are ready. So we are ready to fight with them, and with our own tactics, as we always do, we will fight the full.
Now I think now Kenya, when you're in the country, you're in the country, but you're in the country, and you're in the country.
An expected 557 athletes from 60 teams are set to compete in Uganda's capital on 26th March, and language difference will be key to different countries' tactics.
Now, with a lineup of different countries but speaking a common language, Ngebe will not be the tack for Team Kenya this time out. But there is a secret weapon that is in the offing. Moses Wahesi, KTN Sports. The Kigali Teachers at Training College in Embu County.
All right, so tonight on Checkpoint, we asked you whether the NCIC has succeeded in curbing hate speech in the country. The polls are in. 93% of you say no. 7% of you say yes. I don't believe we've ever had such a statistic on the show before. Let me read two. Anthony Onuti, you say the commission is part of the bloated wage bill, could be scrapped as well. David Ludogoli say MPs who have made legislation have totally sold this country for a song by making weak laws. Those are your views tonight. Thank you very much. Remember, the conversation continues, and perhaps we must continue to think about what's best for the country as we head towards the August 8th polls later this year. Those are your views tonight. My Take is up next. Now, my take tonight is about the proposal from the National Assembly that will no doubt reignite the sibling rivalry it has had with the Senate. So the Budget and Appropriations Committee, in what it says is a bid to tame the ballooning wage bill, has proposed to scrap the Senate and have governors appointed by the president rather than being elected. They want this and a few other proposals put to a referendum on August 8th while we have our general election. Where to begin with this one? Okay, so first, let's do some simple arithmetic, shall we? The National Assembly has 349 members. The Senate has just 67. So if you really want to cut down on expenses, it's rather obvious which one should be scrapped, right? Further, in terms of value for money, I'm not too sure about the value we get from the 349 members themselves. The 11th Parliament will go down in history as being riddled with so many scandals that many have questioned its very ability to oversight the executive. The scandals range from the benign to the most outrageous. In this House, members have falsified travel documents to claim allowances. The Parliamentary Accounts Committee has been involved in a billion shilling scandal. The Agriculture Committee, too, has not been left behind. Let's not even mention the vetting of constitutional commissioners. That is how we ended up with Philip Kinisu, who resigned less than a year later due to a minor oversight by the vetting committee. I could go on, but let's try the other proposal, that of having governors appointed by the president. Who would even think of that in 2017? Does that not take us back to what many Kenyans like to refer to as the dark old days of the monster known as the provincial administration, when some eight very demigods loomed large in the provinces as they did the president's bidding, when one man sitting at State House had the power to decide the fate of millions of citizens hundreds of kilometers away? What is perhaps more surprising about this proposal, though, is the person leading the charge.
Reverend Musimi has been around for decades. If you don't remember him, allow me to refresh your memory. The ordained Baptist minister rose through the ranks within the church to become the general secretary of the NCCK. He led the famous Parallel Constitution Reform Initiative at Ifungamano that was founded on, among other things, the desire to clip the immense powers of the presidency. I therefore find this latest proposal by his committee at odds with the man who has such reformist credentials in this country. The wage bill is a real national question, ladies and gentlemen, and difficult choices will have to be made across the board. But to resort to a shortcut that at the very least undermines the very foundations of devolution is to take the country for a ride. The country must engage in a genuine conversation that may well begin with asking the question of whether the house in which the good reverend sits really needs 349 members. And that tonight is my take. Thank you very much for that and for your feedback, for watching. Thanks for that. Remember, the conversation continues. The hashtag is Checkpoint. Our sign language interpreter tonight was William Silla. And I am Yvonne Okwara Matole. I'll see you again tomorrow night. Bye-bye.